He knows a lot about the science stuff, Professor Dave explains.
In the previous tutorial, we learned all about the Schrödinger equation. We derived different forms of this equation and talked about what all of them represent. Now it's time to apply this knowledge in order to solve our first quantum problem. This will be to find the eigenenergies and eigenfunctions of a particle in an infinite square well. This is also famously known as the problem of the particle in a box. We assume a potential which is as follows. V of x equals infinity everywhere except between x equals 0 and x equals a, within which it equals 0. Let's unpack what that means a bit. We are probably familiar with the concept of a potential, like an electrical potential or gravitational potential, and we know that an object will have a tendency to go towards a lower potential. A ball will fall from some height where it has greater gravitational potential energy, down towards the ground, its potential decreasing as it goes. A compressed spring will relax from a state of higher elastic potential to attain its equilibrium position. So here, when we say that V of x equals infinity for these intervals, this is the mathematical way of saying that the particle is definitely not there. That may seem counterintuitive, as it sounds like infinite potential should mean that it certainly is there. But remember that objects proceed towards a lower potential, and infinity is the opposite of that. So we know the particle is sitting in this square well. The only thing is that since we are looking specifically at a quantum particle, we have to use the Schrödinger equation to figure out where, or more accurately, how the particle lives within these walls. So now what we want to do is to find the wave functions psi of x representing this particle which satisfy the Schrödinger equation. This is the same as asking what are the allowed states for a particle that lives between these walls. What does its probability density function look like under these conditions? And also, what are its allowed energies? All of these answers will arrive from determining which wave functions satisfy the boundary conditions imposed by the potential and the parameters imposed by the Schrödinger equation. The boundary conditions tell us something right away. As we said, the particle will surely not be located wherever the potential is infinity. That means that for those regions, the probability density function must equal zero. If the particle is not there, the probability of finding it there is zero, and the probability density function is equal to zero. The probability density function is psi star times psi, so the only way for this to equal zero is for psi of x to equal zero. Therefore, we are looking for a wave function that will satisfy the following requirements, where psi of x equals zero when x is less than or equal to zero, and also when x is greater than or equal to a. But between x equals zero and x equals a, the wave function does not equal zero, and its value can be determined using the Schrödinger equation. Let's use our new time-independent form of the equation, which as we know looks like this. We will find that isolating the partial derivative will make things easier, so let's move all of these constants to the other side, which will entail multiplying both sides by negative 2m over h bar squared. So now, the second derivative of psi with respect to x is equal to negative 2me over h bar squared times psi. Let's do another trick to simplify further. Let's define k as the square root of 2me over h bar, so that k squared will be equal to 2me over h bar squared. We can plug that into our equation to simplify the right side, which will now be negative k squared psi. And finally, let's bring this term to the left side by adding it to both sides. So we have the second derivative of psi with respect to x plus k squared psi equals zero. This is a second-order differential equation, which we need to solve in order to find psi. And as we know, psi depends on x. Solving this differential equation entails finding all the forms that psi can take to satisfy this equation, just like solving a quadratic algebraic equation entails finding the values that x can take to satisfy the equation. There are simply different rules that must be used to find the solution. For example, if psi of x is equal to x, then when we take the second derivative of x with respect to x, the first derivative is 1, and the second derivative is 0. That leaves us with k squared x equals 0, which can only be true if either k or x equals 0. K can't be 0 because k depends on energy, and if energy is 0, we don't even have a particle to begin with. And in this case, x can't be 0 because psi equals x. Therefore, if x is 0, psi is 0, and the probability density function equals 0, which once again means that the particle does not exist. So this is not a useful solution, because we know that there is a particle. This is a condition for the problem, so we would need to try something else. Now, for brevity, rather than continuing to go through many possibilities, let's just state outright that the solution to this differential equation is of the form psi of x equals a sine kx plus b cosine kx, where a and b are constants that we don't know yet, but we'll determine by using the boundary conditions, and k is as we defined earlier. This may seem out of left field, but this general solution is arrived at through some clear-cut rules that are best omitted here to be covered over in the mathematics series for those who are interested. But this expression represents the solution of the time-independent Schrödinger equation between the walls of the well. Just to quickly prove that this is the solution, we can plug this expression into our rearranged version of the Schrödinger equation. This first term involves taking the second derivative. So let's take the first derivative first. Remembering that the derivative of sine is cosine, and the derivative of cosine is negative sine, and also that the chain rule requires that we bring k out front for each term, that will give us ka cosine kx minus kb sine kx. Then we take the derivative again, and we get negative k squared a sine kx minus k squared b cosine kx. Then we add to that k squared times the original expression, and distributing k squared, we get k squared a sine kx plus k squared b cosine kx. So, as we can see, everything cancels out to give us 0, as should be the case for any solution according to this version of the equation, which means this does indeed satisfy the Schrödinger equation. So, combining this with what we said before, psi equals 0 when x is less than or equal to 0. Psi equals this expression when x is between 0 and a, and psi again equals 0 when x is greater than or equal to a. Let's now try to understand this graphically, as it will provide us with some understanding of the solution. As we said, the wave function must equal 0 at the boundaries. This means that psi of 0 equals 0, and psi of a equals 0. Now, since we have two different trigonometric functions to consider, it will be easier to examine them separately to get a sense of how they combine to give us the value for the wave function. Let's first remind ourselves of what sine of x and cosine of x look like. One important thing to notice is that sine of 0 equals 0, and cosine of 0 equals 1. This means that no matter what value for k we have in our expression, sine of k times 0 is still sine of 0, which will always be 0, and cosine of k times 0 is still cosine of 0, which will always be 1. This means that in order for their sum in our expression to equal 0 when x equals 0, the constant b must equal 0. That means we can simplify our expression and get rid of the cosine term entirely. That leaves us with psi of x equals a sine kx. Now let's examine the other boundary. Psi of a must also equal 0. This could be achieved by setting the constant a equal to 0, but that would mean that psi of x equals 0 for all values of x, which again means that the probability density function would equal 0 for all values of x, and there is no particle, so that is not a useful solution. The other possibility is that sine of kx equals 0, and we are specifically examining the boundary where x equals a, so sine of ka must equal 0. Looking back at our graph of sine of x, we know that it is equal to 0 at x equals 0 and again at pi. and 2 pi, and every successive multiple of pi. Therefore, sine of Ka equals 0 when Ka equals n pi, where n is any integer. This also means that k equals n pi over a. Let's again examine this graphically. To make things simple, let's set a equal to 1, and then examine the graphs of sine of kx, which will therefore be sine of n pi x, and see what happens with different integer values for n. Each of these n values gives us a solution to the Schrödinger equation. We can see that in each case, the wave function has a value of 0 at both boundaries. Recalling that k depends on energy, if k also depends on n, then energy depends on n, and each value of n is giving us a different wave function, or eigenfunction, and a different eigenenergy for the particle. These are the allowed states for the particle. We can see how quantization comes into play here, as n must be an integer in order for the sine function, and therefore the wave function, to satisfy the boundary conditions. The fact that n must be an integer is what imposes quantization on this system. We have just one more thing to do. We have not solved for the constant a, so we still don't know precisely what the wave function looks like. In order to do this, the wave function must be normalized from 0 to a. As we recall from a previous tutorial, we will use this bracket notation to represent the normalization of psi, which will equal the integral from 0 to a of psi star times psi dx. And because we are normalizing, this must equal 1. Now, in this case, psi is a real function. There are no imaginary terms. So psi star times psi is the same thing as psi squared. So let's just square our expression for psi and put that in the integral. That gives us a squared, which is a constant that we can pull out of the integral. And inside the integral, we have sine squared kx dx, which again must equal 1. Now we have to solve this integral, and if we are a little rusty with our integration, we will have to remember that we can use a trigonometric identity here. Sine squared theta can be expressed as 1 minus cosine 2 theta over 2. So let's apply that identity here, and change our expression into 1 minus cosine 2 kx over 2. Let's make this simpler by splitting it into two terms and giving each its own integral. So the integral of 1 half dx minus the integral of 1 half cosine 2kx dx. And we can evaluate these separately. The integral of 1 half is simply x over 2. And plugging in our values, we get a over 2 minus 0, or a over 2. And the other integral isn't much harder, since we know that the antiderivative of cosine is sine. So we get sine 2kx over 2. But then we have to put an additional 2k in the denominator, because we are basically doing the chain rule in reverse. And that will cancel out the additional 2k in the numerator that would occur if this were being differentiated. So now we plug in our values. First we plug in a for x, and then subtract from that the same expression, but with 0 for x. Anything times 0 is 0, and the sine of 0 is 0, so this whole second term is simply 0. Now let's put the results of these two integrals in parentheses so that we can bring back a squared, and then we can make another substitution. We know that Ka equals n pi, so let's make that change. We know that n must be an integer, and we know that the sine of any multiple of pi must be 0. So this entire term will actually be equal to 0. That leaves us with simply uppercase a squared times lowercase a over 2 equals 1. Just a bit more algebra, and we find that uppercase a must equal the square root of 2 over lowercase a. And now that we have solved for A, we can express our solution as a set of wave functions, which are the eigenfunctions that satisfy the Schrödinger equation for the boundary conditions given by the square well. So psi sub n equals root 2 over A sine k sub n times x, where k sub n equals n pi over A, where each integer value of n gives us a different wave function. So when n equals 1, we get psi 1. When n equals 2, we get psi 2, and so forth. Each of these wave functions has an associated eigenenergy. Using our definition of k, we can now express E sub n as being equal to h bar squared k sub n squared over 2m. And given that k sub n equals n pi over a, this will equal h bar squared n squared pi squared over 2m a squared. Again, each integer value of n will give us an eigenenergy which describes the corresponding wave function. And there we have it. So that was definitely a bit of work, but we have successfully solved our first quantum problem. We determined the allowed energies of a particle in an infinite square well, given certain boundary conditions. Even though the problem has been solved, there is still a lot to discuss in terms of the implications of the solution, which will require an entire tutorial unto itself. So let's move forward and get some more perspective on the particle in a box.
Thanks for watching. Subscribe to my channel for more tutorials. Support me on Patreon so I can keep making content. And as always, feel free to email me, ProfessorDaveExplains@gmail.com.